Regional Medical Center and cultivating community. Those are the kind of the backbone that started this project. Harvard Pilgrim in particular is really part of getting this kind of cadre of mobile markets going across New England, all different, working in different cities and different audiences. So it's been really cool to be part of that network, learn from each other and see how the work is being done on the ground. And then many of you are representing partners we work with and customers, but we have sponsors and supporting partners, include Bath Ironworks, the Dard Pharmacy, Goodwill Northern New England, YWCA, YMCA. that's something that neither the YW or the YM like very much. The YMCA, Opportunity Alliance, Center for Women's Women, Westbrook Housing, Westbrook Point, St. Anthony's of Padua, Wisdom Housing Authority, St. Mary's Integrative Medicine, and Wayne Anaheim, to name a few. These are largely our host sites, but also sponsors who have either given us lots of in-kind support or actual sponsoring dollars, which have been hugely helpful. So obviously, these are folks we want to thank. I also really want to thank our team. Not everyone is present, but our good food bus coordinator, Price, who is the master of all the mechanics and logistics of making this project work. He is like clockwork. There's a lot that goes into getting the bus on the road and out in the world every day, and he's really been amazing at that. You can really tell who, you know, if I'm on more prep, you can see that. You can tell that that's me. Things will be everywhere. Price has been very, very organized and amazing on the ground. We couldn't have done it this year. And also our team, Munir, is representing our out in the world team, and formerly Jasmine, who's been part of the Good Food Bus. These folks, along with Kathleen, who's our assistant coordinator, really helped meet the stops happening on the ground this year. We were wonderful with interacting with customers and making sure that we were actually getting them. So thank you to them. Kathleen's at a rehearsal dinner for a wedding tonight, so she can join us. So I wanted to, this tonight's about celebration, it's about gratitude. You know, the project, this 2017 was a real transformative year. I think most of you have seen the transformation. You know, from the onset of the project, we wanted to hit the ground running, so to speak, or in this case, driving, so we can learn from real-time experience. So when a bus, a 30, you know, foot school bus was given to us, we jumped at that opportunity. We learned pretty quickly that that wasn't the best model for us to be doing this work. So we spent the better part of this year really, you know, trying to figure out how can we better meet the needs of folks? How can we get good food in the hands of people? And so it had a lot to do with transforming both the model that we use. So we now, you know, everyone's in 16-foot trailer, and also the team and staff structure in which we do it. And I think we've seen the results of our efforts on the ground. We've really seen a big increase from what we were able to do in terms of food access from last year to this year. So we had a total stops of 14 unique stops that we did this year compared to the 9 from last year. We did almost 3,000 transactions. We had 42% of our sales were low income, which was, we had a total increase of sales from last year, 30%. We didn't list here, but all our numbers went up. How many people we saw, how many pounds of food we sold, how many, you know, folks we were able to reach have all gone up. Our most popular, somebody I didn't get to thank, and the people I wanted to thank, I should step back for a second. We're not listed here, but it should be our farmers, one of whom is in the room, and that's Trent Emery. I wanted to thank him. He's from Emery Farm in Maine. We have little farmer profiles over here, actually, at that point, but Trent and folks from the New American Sustainable Agriculture Project, Fresh Start Farms, supplied the vast majority of our food that we sold on the bus. More than $20,000 went to support local farms through this project this year. You know, farmers like Trent and other Fresh Start farmers were giving us just quality, beautiful, Maine-grown produce week after week after week, and we could not have. And that's a big piece of what we're trying to do. Again, what is a good food bus? Trying to bring good food to where people live, work, and play. But another big piece of what we're trying to do is to find new markets for local food. And sometimes those two goals are, it's a little bit of a rub. Because the real cost of food is sometimes a really hard thing. And so we're trying to figure out how can we lower barriers so people can have the freshest, most high quality food. and also help people understand why that option is a really good option. So that we have a lot of work on the ground for us to do and a lot of work ahead of us. And I think a big driving force for our work is that everybody we know in our community can stand to be eating better food, right? But there are a lot of us in Maine who are really struggling with food insecurity. You know, roughly 200,000 Mainers struggle with hunger, the third highest rate in the country. A sixth of Mainers, quarter of children in Maine experience food insecurity. And then lots of other related health issues when we're just not eating really, not eating well enough, and not enough fruits and vegetables. And that's all of us. And so the Good Food Bus is just really aiming to, we sort of joke around, take away the candy bowl. Like, you have that candy bowl in front of you. I use this analogy in front of Brittany recently. You have that candy bowl in front of us, you're just going to eat the candy. But if you stick a fruit bowl in front of you or a carrot, you know, you're more likely to grab it. So the Good Food Bus is like that fruit bowl. We're trying to put it in front of people's faces. So the ability and desire to grab that carrot or that apple is much, you know, is much easier. And so that's our goal. But we recognize that there's a big task ahead, that the landscape ahead of us too is not fostering the kind of, is not always fostering the positive change towards healthy communities that we want to see. So we know that we're kind of only a small piece of the puzzle, but we want to make sure that we, you know, play our role to the best of our ability and have the greatest impact. And that's a big task ahead of us this year, is to spend a lot of time again in questioning, you know, what is our role in the food system landscape, in bringing food, good food to people. How do we do it best? You know, and that could mean that some of how we do things shifts. And what we're doing right now is gathering input through our surveys. So if you haven't taken our survey, it's here. Or if you're a partner, we're going to be looking to you to share the survey out with audiences as best as you can, so we can get some really hard feedback about what we're doing on the ground, so we can think more strategically for 2018 to see how we can do it even better.
Think about going to the Department of Health and Human Services with those. They might be able to give it to the food stamp people.
Yeah, and they've actually been a real help in getting the word out about the Maine Harvest Bucks program, so I think that would probably be a pretty good resource. So with that said, I want to make sure that, you know, that you all feel up for the task a little bit this winter. We'll be reaching out to you to get your feedback, to work with us, not just with surveys, but we're hoping to do focus groups and come and talk to people. And if you have a meal coming up, for example, Brittany, we'd like to have a presence there. Because we want to hear not just what people think of the Good Food Bus or thought of the Good Foods, what if they could imagine something in their community that would help them get better food? What does it look like? Because we know we're not the only solution, by far may not be the best solution, but we are one possibility, and we want to really take advantage of the possibilities out there. Because whenever there are challenges, there are opportunities, and that's we've had wonderful opportunities with this project, and we just want to seize even more of those coming into the next year. So thank you all again. If you haven't taken the survey, take it here. If you want to buy more food, please do. There's lots left.
Can we ask you questions?
Yeah, sure. I just wanted to make sure to say a little something. But sure, you can ask questions.
But is it paying for itself, or?
It is now. Just, I think we're going to see that we'll cover operational expenses about, which is what we find a lot of projects like this have done. Very few of them can cover the cost of staff. And we know that we're not just your food store, so we are going above and beyond, but we want to even build out even more. So, you know, we had some tip sheets. We want to see a lot more education happening on the ground, a lot more cooking demos. And we feel like anchor meals, which have been really successful this year, we'd like more than, that's not up there, but we'd like doubled how many anchor meals we're selling. What an opportunity to support people in scratch cooking and trying new foods, but we think it could be even more accessible and even more of an opportunity to get people cooking. And so how can we maximize that? We certainly have to also look at the numbers. I mean, there's a lot of work that goes into those bags, but again, the more we sell, the more sense it makes. So certainly we certainly covered the cost of our foods, probably some of our, we had the trailer was a big expense this year, and that's why we have really amazing sponsors and founding partners. concerns. But this year we spent even less than the first year. Going into next year, there's almost no money we're going to have to put into the project infrastructure. It's all there. So in an ideal world, as we continue, we continue to cover the expense. But the truth is, where we live, you know, where we are at now, fruits and veggies are not the big money makers in any, you know, they're hard to be a big money maker. You know, you have to really do volume, and you have to have niche markets, and we're striking that balance of getting good food to people, but also getting food at the real cost of food, which is a hard thing because so much food is subsidized and also wages are stagnant. That's a sobering reality we know about. So even the real cost of food, or even subsidized cost of food, is feeling beyond people's reaches. So we'd love to hear from you too, creative ways, how can we close that gap while not sacrificing the time and labor and the beautiful product of our farmers.
No, actually, our stops are not up there. Those are our supporting partners. They represent a lot of our stops.
Yeah.
That's true. Trent, you may not have seen them.
Do you want to pass them? You can look at our stops.
Okay.
You know, so you have some out of town stops, right? Are you going mostly south? Or are you going north? Does it vary?
We're going south in part because we were asked. We found most success going to places where people like really want us to come. Like Brittany represents Opportunity Alliance and has been a community champion in the Brown Street neighborhood of Westbrook. And they asked us to be there, and we've seen this incredibly warm welcome. Same thing with Goodwill, the IW, like a partnership where when we have on-the-ground champions, this year at the Wisdom Center really was a great stop. When we have on-the-ground champions and people who are like a captive audience, which is often a place of work, but the center is a great spot, we can really be that kind of regular, convenient place for folks to shop. And so
I'm thinking a place up north, up near Augusta, is the Kennebec Behavioral Health, which I go to and look at it. Clubhouse?
Oh, you know what? So that's the thing is, like, we also, part of our geography is where the founding partners are located. So the Nutrition Center focuses on Lewiston, Auburn, cultivating communities, greater Cumberland. And I think that, but there's so much opportunity we know, for example, in rural parts of Maine.
Yeah.
Like, so many of these projects came about because there were urban areas where grocery stores would not build brick and mortar stores.
Lisbon.
So that is another thing we're going to look. We can't. Unfortunately, we have only so much capacity. We can't actually be driving in like Caribou, or unless there's a fleet of us.
Right.
But there are, like, we're a rural state. There are places just 10 minutes. But then we have to figure out, well, where's that key meeting point? How are we going to get people to show up? You know.